It's 9:10 a.m. on November 23rd, 2006. I'm Amy Palmer. I'm interviewing Herbert Palmer at his house in South Glens Falls. What was it like in Glens Falls during the Great Depression?
Oh, you gotta talk a little louder.
What was it like in Glens Falls during the Great Depression?
What was it like in Glens Falls?
Yeah.
Before or after?
During the Great Depression. Before.
Uh-huh.
Before.
When I was a kid. I don't know. Sat around doing nothing much. Working. See, I was working in the Army Depot, I think, at the time. Just before I went in. And I don't know. When the war started?
Yeah, what was it like during the Great Depression?
What
was it like during the Great Depression?
I didn't get that last word.
The Great Depression?
Depression?
Yeah.
Oh, it was pretty poor. I remember my father took us in West Glens Falls, I think it was, just to get a pair of shoes. And we had to walk. We always had enough to eat because they always had a big garden. My father didn't work too often. The place just shut down. And we didn't have everything, and maybe that. Other kids would have, but we had what we really needed, clothing and everything. And we always had dogs and cats.
Where were you when Pearl Harbor was attacked?
That what?
Where were you when Pearl Harbor was bombed?
I believe I was home.
How did you feel?
How did I feel?
Yeah.
Sort of numb. Thought it was a pretty sneaky attack. And I didn't know what was going to happen after that, but I didn't realize I was going to be ended up in the Army. But then again, I figured we would end up in the Army or in the service. And Roosevelt started the draft, and a lot of the guys Glens Falls was drafted, and my brother didn't want to go in the Army or any place just where he didn't want to go. He wanted to go in the Marines, so he enlisted. After he got in there, he wrote a letter and told me not to enlist, just to wait for the draft. So I did, and I was drafted in
41, 42. How old were you when you were drafted?
Hmm?
How old were you when you were drafted?
19, I guess.
How did you feel when you were drafted?
How did I feel?
Yeah.
Well, I knew I'd be going, and I didn't have any feelings toward whether I'd come home or not. That's it, then. And I figure I would, I don't know, I just, sort of dumbfounded, I guess. Wasn't too easy to leave home, but what choice did we have? We didn't have any choices. Either go or to try to avoid it or anything, they'd arrest you. So I went, Clarence went. It's not as bad as I thought it would be. Training, of course, is a little rough. And you got to, when we first went in, give you your clothes, and they just went through a line and they handed you pants and shirts and everything else. Some of them didn't really fit, they were too big. I guess some of the guys had a little bit too small, but then they would trade around until they had something better. And I ain't used to this.
Where were you sent for your training? Where were you sent for your training?
Where did I have my training?
Yeah.
Fort McClellan, Alabama.
What were you trained to do?
I was an infantryman. And I ended up, when we got on the ship to go overseas, well, we went to 13 weeks of basic training in Alabama, which I thought would be warm weather. Didn't have much, no snow, but we had, it turned cold. And you crawled around in a, on your belly and some of the training, and it had old red clay soil, and you had web belts, and you had to keep them, make sure, keep them clean. Took a lot of scrubbing, but it was, I had sort of fun in the training, and I, of course, me, I always try to get out of work. You had to stand guard duty, and you had to do KP. You know what that is?
No.
Kitchen duty. You ended up in the kitchen washing dishes and helping out in the kitchen, stuff like that. Peeling potatoes or whatever the cook told you to do. And you had fairly pretty food, good food. Fried eggs and breakfast, and coffee, and toast, and potatoes, and stuff like that. And then I would always get up and hurry back to the barracks, especially on a weekend. Change my clothes, maybe, and going to PX, post exchange, and you could buy most anything you wanted, ice cream. And at weekends, I would go to a movie maybe at night, and I'd always go to the PX first, and I'd buy half a gallon of ice cream that didn't have a spoon or nothing, so I'd tear off one of the flaps and scoop eat it that way. But I'd finish the ice cream by the time I got to the movie, which is a little distance in between. And came in the spring, took the little stoves you had in your barracks, they take them out and then put this blackened stuff on them. And I knew that this Sunday they was going to be working on that. So me and a few of the guys went and had our breakfast. Then we got all out of the, away from the barracks and the campsite there, went to PX or wherever we could there. Some of them, I guess, went to town or tried to go to town. But you had to volunteer more. Well, they didn't. If you volunteered, you get asked for volunteers. And if nobody would say anything, they'd say, well, you volunteer. You. And they had up. So we got into town and then stayed away from the barracks and camp all day. And along 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, three or four of us went and we walked by where we could see what was going on. They were still working on them, so we went over and laid down underneath the shade until we figured they were all done. Get that old black stuff all over you. And that's one way I got out of work. And of course, we had a trained in go to the rifle range and practice there. I was I wasn't no sharpshooter, that's for sure. I forget now what they called the other one. And we were trained with all the 1819 World War I rifles, the old Springfield rifles, when we first went in, till they got the M1s, which was a semi-automatic, and you had to learn how to take them apart in the dark and put them together again. I wasn't too good at that, but you had to do it. And I always got guard duty, of course. I wasn't exactly sociable like some of the other guys that would always end up going to town on the weekends. I'd go to the PX or somewhere, read or do something else. I was more or less, a loner. And of course, and there were several guys in the barracks, and you each had your own bunk there. This one guy would wake up in the middle of the night, come over and wake me up and say, hey, turn over. I thought he'd be snoring. He did that sometimes, a couple of times.
After your training, where were you sent?
Where was I sent?
Yeah.
And we had to get ready, and they sent us up to Fort Dix, New Jersey. And, of course, from there, we were sent overseas. You couldn't, they wouldn't allow you to call home or anything. I guess you could call, but you were monitored. And if you said anything about where you were, or anything, where you were going or anything, they'd cut you right off on the phone even. So it was a few minutes. I talked to Ma, that was all. And I hadn't talked to her or seen them in 3 years I was in. From there we went to New York and got on the ship. And the Red Cross is usually there at the ships, letting you have donuts and coffee for free. When you got on or off, and we took about five or six days to go across. Ended up in North Africa. Of course, there was no fighting there then. We were replacements for ones that got killed. And we were there for, I don't know, a few weeks. And slept in pup tents.
What are those?
Hmm?
What are those?
Well, it's... Dad. Like two halves fastened together, and you put them on like that, and you crawled into them. Couldn't very well walk in them, they weren't that big. But if it rained and you touched it, it would start leaking. That was pretty dry weather there. It was, of course, the Arabs, or whatever you call them, was always around, and you had to watch your stuff, because a lot of them would steal it. And I know there was one camp there, and the guards shot one of them. Killed him. They notified his parents, or his wife and kids. They just went up, took the clothes all out from him, and left the body there. So they had to make him take, dispose of the body. But the guard was fined $6. $2 went to the family, and the rest went to the king. Life is cheap over there. And of course, one night me and the guy was sharing a pup tent. It was just as before we got in there, we seen this little animal-like with a curled tail, scorpion. Wasn't very big. Scoot right into the tent. So we went and got him out of there before we went in. And people there would come around and sell the GIs bottles of wine. And to look at them, you wouldn't think they had any on them. But I noticed there was one man there had like a cloak on. I don't know how many bottles he sold. to look at him, otherwise you wouldn't think he had anything. He was pulling the pockets, hurt bottles of wine, and it wasn't, I guess, best of wine for what the guys told me. I never bought any because I never drank. And then to there we went down toward, there was fighting in Africa, but it was on the other, down, away from us a lot, and they were shipped to, forget the name of the town now. Well, anyway, we got on a ship there, and we ended up over in southern France, or, no. Went to Palermo, Sicily. We were there 2 or 3 weeks or so, and officers came and read your names off to go to what outfits you'd go into. Trained as an infantryman. But going on the ship overseas, they had to stand guard duty every morning about 2 hours to keep the soldiers away from the end of the ship where the nurses and wax were. And about 2 hours of guard duty there in the morning and 2 at night. In the afternoon, and I ended up in the MPs, military police. They had got to Sicily, that's where these guys, Major and Captain, came in, and other officers, and they were reading off guys' names, where all they would go. Of course, an awful lot of them went into infantry, and I was wondering where the heck what I was going to go. And then this MPs called my name, so I ended up in the Division MPs. And I was never trained as one, exactly. But that's where I ended up in. And of course, had a... Then we was taking, I forget now where we went from there. Anyway, we ended up... what town it was, we got on the ship. I went to southern France, the southern part of France. That's where we hit, and we didn't have any problems getting in, as I don't remember any. And I was never in actual combat where they were shooting you. Or shooting at you, but there was artillery was thrown at you and stuff like that. And the people there, they were lined up more or less when they got off the ship and everything, and guys were throwing gum at them and everything, they were happy to see you. They were, Germans gave them a rough time.
How close did you come to the enemy?
How
close did you come to the enemy?
The enemy? I don't know, 2 or 3 miles behind the line. In Italy, No, we didn't. It was Sicily. We went to Italy. Not, sorry. We went to Italy. And down in the toe there in the southern part of Italy first. And, I forget whether that's the place now where the Germans had their cannons aimed at the beach. And they never fired a shot. They didn't fire them off. They moved in fast there. And then you run into a lot of opposition. And after they got up past Naples, and up in the mountains outside of Naples, they put up a fierce fight. They had a lot of, I guess there was big caves in that mountain that the Germans hid in. Then they'd come out and throw artillery stuff at you. And then they'd go back in there, we'd start firing back. And there was, I remember one day, one of our generals, I guess, and one from the German army went up and stood up near the front lines. Then our people came in and picked up the dead and the wounded, because there were so many of them around. They had to clean the place up first. Then they went back to fighting. And after we pushed out of there, and we went to, we headed for Rome. I ended up in Anzio, Italy. And that's where, outside of the towns, where I was wounded. And we couldn't dig a foxhole. Me and my buddy from Kentucky, he was hard of hearing, but he could hear better than I. We went, some of the spots you could dig down in good, and others you'd hit water if you went too deep. So we went and built a mud wall around us, about 2 feet thick, and every garbage and anything we didn't want, we'd throw in there and cover it up. And we had a little doorway light, and a little step there, and I was standing there when I heard the artillery, a shell coming through. It sounded like a freight train, to me anyway. And that's, I thought it would end up over toward the hospital or the airport more. And one of them landed about 50 yards behind me, and that's where I was wounded, in the leg. And that hit me. I went down like a, I don't know, poof. Like someone clobbered you over the head real hard. And then they run me to the hospital. Of course, they put me in the Jeep and run me over there. The Jeep had quite a puddle of blood on the bottom of the floorboard by the time we got there. But there was guys in the hospital over there that was in worse shape than me. Some of them had their legs all bandaged up and their bodies. One guy had, I noticed, it was in the cot next to me in there. He had a stand. He was out on road work, I guess, directing traffic and stuff, or guard duty, and a shell landed, I think, somewhere near him, or a bomb, I forget which. And shrapnel hit him in the rear end and came out of his stomach. Well, he had tubes coming out of his stomach, but he was getting up better all the time. But there was other guys in there that was in bad shape. And of course, that was about 2-3 miles from the front lines there, closer than I were anywhere else. The Germans up in the mountains was throwing, they had a rest camp there for the soldiers to give them a break from the front lines. And officer had them all fall out for, I forget, Reverly or whatever, anyway. But it was sort of a dumb thing to do because they could look right down your throats and they shelled them. A lot of guys got wounded or killed there. When they, just before they really pushed out from Anzio to go to Rome. I was wounded before that, so they sent me over to a ship there. Then I ended up on a British hospital ship. And they pushed up there and to Rome. The southern part of Italy wasn't exactly the cleanest thing in the world. I mean, they had narrow streets, and in the winter time, I think it rained every day during the month. You know, you always had one day the sun to come out and really be hot. And that's where I rejoined them up near Rome. And I ended up with yellow jaundice. And I forget where I was. I guess I was in France though when I got that. And from there we went to France, southern part of France. And then we pushed out of there. And that's where I think, I don't remember exactly where he got into France, Eileen's father. And he was only a few miles from me, but I didn't know it then, till later. And they got up toward the Rhine River, and the Germans were well fortified there with their pillboxes and everything. They had a hell of a time to getting through there. But I've seen night, they'd send our bombers to go over to bomb Germany, and the sky would be filled with them, fighters, and bombers, and it'd be a few hours, then they'd be returning. Well, didn't get shot down or anything, but I did see a few dogfights where our fire plane was fighting another German plane, and we ended up, and there was one place where a German plane came over and they shot it down, and it landed a little ways from where I was. It hit the ground and blew a hole on the ground and almost dropped a small house in it, and I could see the guy's face, and and the pilot, I guess he was probably dead. But he sure was dead when that thing hit, because it exploded. And it still had a bomb on the left bottom.
What went through your mind when you were wounded?
What was this?
What went through your mind when you were wounded?
What went through my mind?
Yeah.
I wasn't quite sure. Nothing much. All I did, it hurt. Not right away. When it first hit, I didn't feel nothing for a while. And then when I went into the service, I didn't really care whether it came out or not. If I did, okay. If I didn't, it didn't really bother me then. But I was wounded and I seen these other guys. They were in worse shape than me, and I figured I was lucky. But I only had one little hole in me. Some of them had half their legs blown off and stuff. That part. And what else you got there?
What was the war like for your brother?
Huh?
What was the war like for your brother?
What was it like?
Yeah.
Well, when he was killed, Berta, I think, sent me a letter telling me, and she wrote it out in the letter that he was killed. But she figured I'd be reading the letter. She took the clipping out of the newspaper and stuck in there, and that was the first thing I seen. When I pulled that newspaper clipping out, and the first thing I seen was Clarence Palmer killed in action. And he was on guard duty, I guess, and a sniper shot him, got shot through the head. So I guess he didn't have much pain. And I don't know, I just had a funny feeling go through me at the time, that I didn't feel much of anything. And then later I found out that Ma got the telegram. I was reading that. Bert, of course, always the nosy one, went up and read over her shoulder about it. And from what they told me, she let one big scream. I didn't have too much feelings right then for some reasons. after I read that letter, it just hit me that for a little while when I read it, and after that it didn't bother me too much. I just figured, well, and how I ended up coming out alive, I don't know. I guess it's a lot of the prayers that Ma had there and a lot of other people. The only thing that saved me, I don't know. But Clarence came home on a furlough, and before he left, he told my mother that he had the feeling he wouldn't make it out. And of course, I met a lot of I didn't see too many of the guys I was trained with in basic training, but I did see a few. And one of them was a machine gunner, and he says, "I got the feeling I ain't coming out of here alive." I never seen him after that. But you can bet your life, you get in the front lines like that, and you're gonna live, you might say, through a living hell. Why am I getting emotional? And
what was it like when the war ended?
Well?
What was it like when the war ended?
When the war ended?
Yeah.
I was glad. And a lot of other guys were too. I was in France. You know, campsite there where they were sending you home. And that's where I met Eileen's father. No, it wasn't either. I never seen him over there until we got home. But he was in one ship, I guess, and I was in another. And down and got to New Jersey, Fort Dix, and I was standing there with a paper, making out a paper that they gave us to sign to discharge, you know. I don't remember what was on it. But I didn't have no table or nothing, so I'm doing it on a post. And someone tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around, and here was her father. And I kept looking at him. He looked familiar, but I couldn't think of who the heck it was until he starts saying, well, who I was, where I come from and everything. Then it dawned on me that it was her father, Dan. And from there we were discharged in Fort Dix. And I was discharged the day before he was. And he asked me to stay overnight, come home together, but I wanted to get home, so I took off, and my buddies there in New York City, going along with him, and he took me for a walk down Broadway, You can have New York City, I don't want it. And from there he took me over where the train stations were. I got on the train to come home. And I remember that I remember I was on the train. Or was it a bus? One of them, I stood up most of the way on there. And I got to Albany, and I took the bus to Saratoga. Went to my sister's house, Marion, and then it was on a weekend, and they usually went to Glens Falls shopping and stuff that night. So I stayed there and then rode up with them, and that Berta, Helena, Dorothy all worked in behind the soda fountains in Kresge's. And I went, got out there, I went into the soda fountain there. Helena was right behind the counter doing something. And so I went and I swung at her, but she didn't pay no attention. And I sat down on a stool right in front of her. She had a surprised look on her face. And then Berta and Dorothy come and talked to them. And next thing I know, I never told my mother I was coming or when I would be there. She knew I was coming sometime. Next thing I know, she almost knocked me off the stool. She's standing outside and she seen me, and she come rushing in and wrapped her arms around me and almost knocked me off the stupid stool. Then I went home with them, but it seemed awful good to get home.
What was it like going back to civilian life? What was it like going back to civilian life?
I didn't get it.
What was it like going back to civilian life?
Back to civilian life?
Yeah.
I thought it was great, I guess. And of course then I spent a little time at home running around meeting people and stuff, and then I had to find a job, and I worked in the Marionette Paper Company was down where Scott is in Southland Falls. No. It was in the paper mill just the other side of the bridge. It's what now? Just this side of the bridge, across from Finch and Prine's. That paper mill there, it was called the Marionette. And then the Scott Paper Company moved to Fort Edward. They took it over there, and they moved it all down to Fort Edward. And that's where they sort of let me go. Because I didn't show up lots of times for work at night. I'd rather run around. And from there, I really don't remember where I went to work. Anyway, I ended up in NIPCO and worked there. 33 years there in the foundry.
How was life at home different from when you left? How was life at home different from when you left?
Not too much. At the home, it was about the same. Where Clarence got his driver's license. Before he went in, so I went with him a few times. We worked for Uncle Walt up in Cleverdale for a while at the store. I did. I drove back and forth. At home itself was more or less the same. Dad went to work. Early in the morning, he'd walk down to Lexington Avenue lots of times to the bus to go to work. Of course, off and on, he got laid off a lot for that machine. He was a machinist over on Cooper Street. And his brother worked there too, and so finally he got a job in the bag mill in Hudson Falls, but it's not the bag mill anymore, it's down along the river there, and when he came home at night, he had the car, but he never drove it much to work. It was cheaper for him to go to the bus, or he would go over to the corner of Metal Brook Road, Ridge Street, and a guy from lived up on the Ridge Road or toward Lake George there, he'd come along and pick him up, and he would pay him a little bit for gas and stuff, and ride to work with him for a while, there's lots of times when we went to town a lot then for a while it was Friday nights, and then they changed it to Thursday when all the stores were open until 9 o'clock. But if he drove down the street, he would always park up around Washington Street on Ridge, because it was hard to get parking spaces down around the stores, and then we would have to walk. And lots of times we would have to walk all the way down and all the way home. We went to school.
Well, you don't want to hear about that.
The old Ridge Street School down where the fire station is now on Ridge. And of course, when we did go to school, we had to walk, didn't have buses. So you walked down to school and you walked home. And I had a lot of fun then too. That was before I went into service, of course, but. And
how do you think your parents felt about the war?
What did I want?
How do you think your parents felt about the war?
I don't know, they never talked too much about that. I know they didn't like it, but they kept a lot of their feelings to themselves about that. At least I never heard them say too much about it. But I know they didn't like it. And I know they missed us, I guess, 'cause the letters that I got when I was overseas, during the Army. And she gave me the news at home, and I would always wait and get two or three letters from them. Then I would answer all three.
How did you feel about the war?
I didn't like the war. Now, I wasn't exactly crazy about it, but I sort of, some parts of it I enjoyed and liked. And I had fun at times, but there was times when you didn't. Training, well, to me it was rough, but I also found out that some of the other Army outfits was having it rougher than me. They had a company with guys that were flat-footed, and I know guys in the company I wasn't in training was flat-footed, and so he figured he'd have it easier if he would transfer over to the other company where they were all that way. And he found out that was rougher than where he was before. He had a lot of hikes, I guess. And you always carried a full field pack. You go bivouacking or anything. I don't remember carrying a rifle there to bivouac where they played war games. But I know we had a march out to it, and had a march back. If you go on a march, go maybe 2 or 3 miles or more, and that could be any time, day or night, rain or no matter what. And if you're out marching, and even if it wasn't raining, and of course you had to stay in formation. If you came to a puddle of water, one guy stepped out around it, and the sergeant made him go back and walk through it. Because you didn't. You wasn't, well, you had to walk through that crap in the battlefield. It had to be most anything you come to. You couldn't always walk around it, you had to go through them. So, that's the way he was trained. And I enjoyed it a little, but I'd of course rather be home than down there or over there. And I sort of, at the end of the war, or you got something else before that? I sort of I just had a feeling of I dreaded coming home in a way, and in a way I was glad I was coming home, and I
dreaded it because you got in the habit of cursing and swearing in the Army, because everybody did. And even if you didn't go in and you never swore, you'd end up swearing. And I figured if you got home, the one thing I dreaded most was be sitting around the table with my sisters and my parents, that I'd end up swearing someplace along the line. And I did. And then all of a sudden they had this look on their face and I realized what I had said. But you say it so much that you almost, part of your conversations and stuff.
What parts of the war did you enjoy?
What president?
What parts of the war did you enjoy?
Was I in? I didn't get this.
What did you enjoy about the war? You said that you had fun.
Anyway, I had buddies. A lot of them would, they would play cards and stuff, and I never did that. And I suppose laughed, joked, talked to my buddies. I had one more or less special buddy in training in Fort Dix or Alabama. And he lived in New York City. We were quite chummy with him. Had good times together. And I never was one to get a lot of passes and go into town like most of them did. And a lot of them end up drunk coming home. I was wounded in the Army. I had Ella Jones there. And I always, somehow, it would always happen just before the big push out of the front line in one town or another. Where'd you dream up all these questions?
Did you think the war was necessary? Did you think the war was necessary?
World War. I didn't get it.
Did you think the war was necessary?
World War One.
World War Two.
Was that about the same as... Sorry, I didn't...
Did you think the war was necessary? Did we need to have the war?
Was I?
Did you think the war was needed? Did you think the war was needed?
Did I do anything with?
Did you think World War II was needed? Do you think it was important? Did you think that the war was needed?
Needed?
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, in a way, I guess, yes. Because I figured that if it wasn't to go over there to war, they would end up over here. If they kept pushing, and if the Germans kept pushing and from one country to another, the way they were taking them, And of course the Japanese begin to hit Pearl Harbor. And of course I didn't like that. That was a sneaky trick. And the way they were pushing across the island, you didn't know whether what was going to happen there. I figured if keep the war over there or somewhere else instead of our country. That's what I thought anyway.
Do you find it hard to watch movies about World War II?
That what?
Do you find it hard to watch movies about World War II?
I still, sorry, I didn't get it.
Do you find it hard to watch movies about World War II?
No, not really hard. But a lot of it was true. Some of it wasn't. Some of it was their own makeup, I guess. When you see a picture where soldiers are all marching down the highway with all grouped together, it was a danger. Or when you were in the front lines, you didn't always stay a big separation from the other guys. Because if you was lined up with somebody else, you could get shot. The bullet could go through you and kill the guy behind you or in front of you. Or injure them, especially an armored piercing bullet. Or I don't know if a tracer would or not, but they always had tracers in there. Rifles too, especially at night, because then they could tell where they were shooting.
Did you think that Truman was right to use the atomic bomb?
Did I what?
Did you think that Truman was right to use the atomic bomb?
I don't think I understood you.
Did you think that Truman was right to use the atomic bomb?
Did I? I'm sorry.
Did you think that Truman was right to use the atomic bomb?
Talk a little slower, Ann.
Did you think that Truman was right to use the atomic bomb?
Oh, the atomic bomb?
Yeah.
Well, yes, I thought I did. At least that ended the whole war. The Japanese gave up then. And that was the end of the war. Of course, the war in Europe ended up sooner than before the other Asia did. And the atomic bomb finished that off. Of course, it wasn't no pretty sight or anything with that radiation hitting so many thousands of people that it just got burned. And that way, I didn't approve, but I think in a way it was saved a lot of our lives, American lives. Kept them from going in the service and in the war. Because it ended it. And so I think it was in a way a good thing. In a way, of course, it wasn't. Of course, now they got all this stuff there. Other countries got the stuff to make bombs with. And it was... And it could end up over here too. The way this war has changed now, the terrorist is entirely different than fighting from one city to another. Of course, they still do, but it's what you never know in a, where the terrorists are going to be, because they're no uniform. They're just like anyone else. And they hide somewhere and snipe you. And these road bombs, then they turn around and say, well, it's God's approval. Well, I don't think to believe that. Of course, God always says that there's always going to be wars, or rumors of wars. And that's the way it's been true all down through the centuries, as far as I know.
Why do you think it's important to remember World War II?
Why is it important to remember World War II?
Yeah.
Because at there they figured that there was a World War II would end all wars, but it didn't. So I don't know, it's crippled so many of the guys. So many of them died. Some of them suffered a lot before they did die. And I don't know, I just don't like wars. You never know what's going to happen. I don't know.